This video is published under the Creative Commons license BY-NC-SA, which means attribution, non-commercial and share-alike. Third-party material has been used for which the permission is specified explicitly for every diagram, photograph or whatever has been used. Please mention the author as Andreas Pfennig, Products, Environment and Processes, Department of Chemical Engineering, Université de Liège, Belgium. A disclaimer applies. Welcome back to this video series on thermal unit operations. We are back into the chapter on general considerations, and in this video I would like to continue, finalize, so to speak, those things I want to talk about concerning shortcut methods. In the last video we developed shortcut method, that is equations that allow us to determine the performance of equipment and design that equipment based on simple equations that you can evaluate on a calculator or an Excel spreadsheet. And the cases we regarded were the single stage as well as the cross-current multi-stage process. And in this video I would like to show the next complication, so to speak, which is the counter-current process. So here we have depicted such a counter-current process. And what we actually want to do is we want to also in this case find a working equation that then allows us to step through that process theoretical stage by theoretical stage. And we see that the nomenclature is presumably as you would expect. That is, on the one hand side we have a x0 entering, from the other side we have a y0 entering, so an L dot and a G dot with the corresponding compositions. And then the phases are passing through these several theoretical stages in a counter-current fashion. The balance we want to set up is related to theoretical stage N, the general theoretical stage, and of course again the leaving concentrations carry the index of that stage. And since they are in equilibrium, as we have discussed already several times, that's the assumption of the theoretical stage, that the leaving streams are in equilibrium, the compositions, the x and the y, leaving that stage, carrying the same index, they are in equilibrium. From the left, the xn minus 1 is entering, from the right, the yn plus 1. And now we want to apply the balances to that, as we did also already last time. Well, what do we obtain? Of course, steady state, no chemical reaction, do you remember those options that were available, mass, molar based and total fluxes or carrier fluxes? These are the four main possibilities that exist. And now you want to apply it actually in this case with the loads and the carrier flow rates, because that is for these shortcut methods the typical case where you apply that. So we have steady state, no chemical reaction, that is the left side of the equal sign is zero. No change inside the system. Then we have the two entering streams, which is on the one hand side the L dot times the xn minus 1 plus the G dot times yn plus 1. The two leaving streams, which are those which are in equilibrium, which carry the index of the theoretical stage they are leaving, that's just the L dot xn minus the g dot yn. That's one thing. The second thing we realize that we have to combine that always according to the mesh principle, MESH principle, with the equilibrium condition. And the equilibrium is described as yn equals k times xn. And we again want to use the generalization by adding the c, as you will see will just cancel in the next step. So we can describe it that way, and that's the assumption. Of course, we need to know the equilibrium for the system that we want to separate, as we always need to know. And now we can simply proceed. What do we do? Well, we substitute all y's by x's. What are does that lead to? Well, 0 equals, well, y's by x's, so we just copy the L dot x n minus 1 plus the g dot, and then we substitute the yn plus 1 by, well, first write it in brackets, step by step, k xn plus 1 plus c minus l dot xn, and then we want to substitute this yn in this way, it's exactly written, so minus g dot times k xn plus c, and we directly see, as I said, the g dot c with a negative sign here, the g dot times c with a positive sign, though the c cancels, so we get rid of that term directly, and we can collect, so to speak, the terms. As I always say, I prefer to rewrite the equations really step by step, that way I know that I don't make too many errors in between. So it's l dot xn minus 1 plus g dot k xn plus 1 minus l dot xn minus g dot k xn. And we again see, so to speak, that we here have more or less already a working equation to a certain extent, which allows us to step from theoretical stage minus 1 and n to the next stage, and that's exactly what we want to do, so to speak. In order to achieve the real working equation, we want to simplify that, so we want to solve for the for one of these x's, either this or that, and actually we'll be using this one. So we divide by the l dot and then solve for the xn minus 1. So if we first divide by the l dot, we obtain a 0 equals xn minus 1 plus g dot k over l dot times xn plus 1 minus, l dot, we divided by that, so minus xn minus g dot k over l dot times xn again. And now we can, of course, on the one hand side, substitute the g dot k over l dot by the lambda, we know that already. So lambda equals g dot k over l dot, that's one thing. We can substitute that, and then we want to solve for the xn minus 1. So what do we obtain? Xn minus 1 equals, and now of course, if we bring these last three terms to the other side of the equal sign, these both will be positive, that will be negative. So let's first take these two, and they actually both contain an xn, so that is a positive xn with two terms that we can collect in brackets. This is the lambda, this is just a 1, so it's lambda plus 1 minus this term, which is just minus lambda xn plus 1. And that's exactly the equation that we want to apply over and over again. That's, so to speak, our working equation. Well, how do we deal with that? As before, for the cross-counter process, we start at one end and then work our way through the entire process and then see how it works overall, because then in the end, if we do that, we combine one end, so to speak, with the other end via the intermediate steps and theoretical stages, so we have some terms that will contain the number of theoretical stages, and then we can hopefully solve for this number of theoretical stages. So we apply that first for stage 1. Well, we first write it down, and then I tell you again, we need to check something. So we have the x0, n equals 1, so xn minus 1 is x0, equals x1 times lambda plus 1 minus x2 times lambda, and I write it this way around. As I said again, for the first and the last theoretical stage, we always have to check, so we have to see if this really corresponds to what is taking place, so to speak, in the process, because that refers to stage n minus 1, which is the stage 0. We don't have a stage 0, so that does that nomenclature make sense? So we have to go back to the presentation, and here we see that the x1 actually, n minus 1 is here, is the x0 indeed, and it is as if it were, so to speak, coming from a previous theoretical stage. So as if it were coming from a theoretical stage 0. So the indexing is correct at that point. And you always have to check if you do these things for the first and for the last theoretical stage, because there, in principle, things could go wrong. You could have called that, for example, x alpha or something like that, and you would need to account for that, of course. Then we want to apply that directly to the stage 2. Okay, same thing. X1, so n minus 1 is now, so the n is 2 now, so n minus 1 is 1, times the x2 times lambda plus 1 minus x3 times lambda. Oh, interesting. Now we have an expression for the x1, and we can, of course, substitute that in here. Yeah, this first equation contains the x1, so we can substitute it here. So what do we obtain? We obtain x0 equals, now the x1 times lambda plus 1, so it's actually x2 times lambda plus 1 squared. So this term substituted, this expression substituted in this term, so it's this times that, minus this times that. So actually it is minus x3 times lambda times lambda plus 1. So now we have substituted these two terms in here. And we still have this term, so it's minus x2 times lambda. Now we can look at these terms in a little bit more detail and can sort them directly by the concentration. So we have the x0 equals x2 times, and now what do we have? It's a lambda squared plus 2 lambda plus 1. This is this lambda plus 1 squared. But also we have a minus lambda here, so it's a minus lambda. Minus x3 times, and now we have this product, lambda times lambda plus 1. That's just a lambda squared plus lambda. And we realize, of course, that this lambda cancels against this 2. So what we actually have is an x0 equals x2 times lambda squared plus lambda plus 1 minus x3 times lambda squared plus lambda. Okay, now let's proceed. How does that look now for stage 3? We still see our working equation. So we have an x n minus 1 for n being 3, so it's an x2 equals the xn for n equals 3 is the x3 times lambda plus 1 minus the x n plus 1, which is x4 in this case, times lambda. Okay, so now we realize the same procedure as before. We can substitute that in here in this equation. Yeah, so we can just take this x2, plug it in here. And what we obtain is, actually I don't work that out, you can do that if you have too much time at home. You obtain x0 equals x3 times lambda cubed plus lambda squared plus lambda plus 1 minus x4 times lambda cubed plus lambda squared plus lambda. So what we actually see that for each additional theoretical stage, the indices are just being increased by 1. For stage 3, this is the x of that theoretical stage, that is the next x. And also we see that one additional term is added here with respect to lambda to that power of the stage that we are regarding. And of course we can directly generalize that if you like. We can say for stage capital N, we can say, well, first the working equation, it's xn minus 1, so it's an x capital N minus 1 equals the xn times the lambda plus 1 minus the xn plus 1, x capital N of course, n plus 1 times lambda. What does, we have directly realized something, xn plus 1, what does that relate to? Let's have a look. Xn plus 1, actually this is so to speak the x of the next theoretical stage that doesn't exist. Well, where does it come from? Well, actually because this here is the y n plus 1. This is the y that is coming from the next theoretical stage in our systematic nomenclature, but of course it's not coming from a theoretical stage, that's our entrance feed. Only in our systematic nomenclature that would be the y n plus 1. And since we have replaced all y's by x's, we so to speak substituted that by the corresponding equilibrium x. So we have, like before for the cross current, this is so to speak resembled by the corresponding equilibrium value. So instead of writing y n plus 1, we write the corresponding equilibrium condition and the corresponding x to have a systematic nomenclature, and that actually defines this xn plus 1. So if you want to replace that in some sensible way, we can say on the one hand side that actually this, how should I write that, the xn plus 1 equals the x0 star, where we know that that is actually defined by the y0, which we know, which is the known inlet composition at that side of the process, which corresponds to the yn plus 1 in our systematic nomenclature, and we know that that is, so to speak, k times x0 star plus c. So our y0, so to speak, defines is that and defines this x0 star, which we actually have in this place. Okay, knowing that, we can then also write the generalized form of this equation here, because that is, how does that look like now? So it's an x0 equals, on the one hand side, it's the xn times lambda to the power of n. The highest exponent is always that of the theoretical stage we are regarding. Here we are regarding theoretical stage n, so the highest power is that of n, plus lambda to the power of n, well, minus 1, plus and so on, lambda squared plus lambda plus 1, minus the x0 star times, again, lambda to the nth power plus and so on, plus lambda squared plus lambda. So that starts, that ends, so to speak, at the lambda, but starts already at the lambda again to the power of that, well, of that theoretical stage we are regarding, so the lambda to the nth power. Okay, this is nice, of course, but it's a little bit not so efficient, this equation. What can we do about that? Well, apparently we would like to combine these two bracketed terms, but for that, actually here, plus 1 is missing. If this would be a plus 1, then we could actually combine these two terms. So here we would like to have actually an additional x0 star, but of course if we add that, we also need to subtract that, and that's exactly what we want to do. So we want to rewrite that, x0 equals, the first term is term remains the same, x to the power of n times lambda to the power of n, plus, I skip this n minus 1 term in this equation, because we don't need it actually, we know it's there, but we don't need to expel that out, minus the x0 star to the power of lambda, times lambda to the power of n, plus lambda squared plus lambda. And then we say, well, we have a minus x0 star, and that we can combine into that bracketed term. But if we say minus, we also have to have a plus, so plus x0 star. Okay, nice. So what do we do next? Well, we now bring this term to the other side of the equation. So we have actually an x0 minus x0 star equals xn, I should write what I'm saying, xn minus x0 star. Now times this bracketed term, which is lambda to the nth power plus and so on, lambda squared plus lambda plus 1. Yeah, this minus x0 star goes in here, gives a plus 1, because the minus is taken care of here, so that's a plus 1. So this bracketed term is the same as that, so we can combine these two terms. This is then this xn minus this x0 star times this bracketed term. Okay, so far so good. What next? Now, of course, we realize that there are mathematical expressions that allow us to directly write that in a closed form. Writing it generally, mathematically, so to speak, one can say the summation from I equals 0 to some general n of a1, which may be some prefactor for the first term, times q to the power of I, where q is actually that multiplier that is added from each between each of these terms, equals a1 to the times 1 minus q to the power of n plus 1 divided by 1 minus q. Now, spelling that out for our case, how does that look like? Well, we can say the summation I equals 0 to capital N of lambda to the power of I. Now, this expresses exactly this term. I equals 0 is lambda to the 0's power is 1. This is this, it's this one. Next term is I equals 1 is exactly that lambda. The last term is lambda to the nth power. Yeah, that's this. So what we have here is exactly that summation. We see we don't have an a1, so that is not there as well. So that's just a ratio. It's 1 minus this factor, which in our case is lambda, to the power of n plus 1, because what was the small n in the mathematical nomenclature now is here in our special case the capital N. So it's 1 minus lambda to the power of n plus 1 divided by 1 minus lambda. Easy. And then we can, of course, directly substitute that. And we can also, of course, realize, as we did also for the cross-current process, we can divide by this. So we have a ratio of concentration differences equals something that contains the lambda and the n. So that's the type of equation we would like to have. So what we obtain is that we have the x0 minus the x0 star divided by the x capital N minus x0 star equals 1 minus lambda to the power of n plus 1 divided by 1 minus lambda. This is again a form of this Kremser equation, now written for the countercurrent process. So that is one of the final equations that we get, so to speak. Oops. Because that links again the number of theoretical stages, some information about the flow rates and the equilibrium, and the concentration spread that we can achieve by the separation. These two being the inlet compositions, this is the x0, this corresponding to the y0, we know, saw before how that links, and the purity specification xn, if that should be the one which is given. So that is again a form of the Kremser equation. And just to remind us, lambda equals g dot k over l dot, and the x0 star, it was not spelled out that way around above, but if you solve it for that, you get y0 minus c over k. And now we can solve this, of course, for the n. If we do that, we obtain, with the corresponding logarithm rules, we obtain it's the logarithm of, well, it's a little bit complex, and one can't directly see that, because actually, if we do that, we have to multiply by this term, we have to subtract this 1, then we have a negative sign here, and then we get actually the result for n plus 1, so we have to subtract the 1 in the end again. And if we do all that, the final result looks like that. It's a natural logarithm of minus x0 minus x0 star divided by xn minus x0 star times this 1 minus lambda plus 1. So this is the term from which we need to take the logarithm, divided by the logarithm of the lambda. And then we also need to, as I said already, subtract the 1. Yeah, because we obtain actually, if we just do the logarithm, we obtain the n plus 1, so we have to subtract that 1 again. So that is then our final equation, which is, again, the solution of the Kremser equation for this n. And as obtained previously, as we have seen for this cross-current process, we can also solve this, so to speak, by substituting not all wires by X's as we did here, but do it the other way around. We can substitute all X's by Y's, and then we get, of course, a result which is based on the concentrations with respect of the Y's. I would like to have both of them on the same slide. So if we do that, we obtain that the Y0 minus Y0 star, which we know already from the cross-current process, divided by Y1 minus Y0 star equals 1 over lambda to the nth power minus lambda divided by 1 minus lambda. And of course, you guess that apparently the y0 star has something to do with the x0. Actually, that's a different notation, so to speak, for the x0, because all x's have been substituted by the y, so we have to have some virtual equilibrium concentration expressed in y that corresponds to the x0. So the y0 star is just the k times x0 plus c, so it's just a numerical value, doesn't exist anywhere in the process, the same as for the x0 star. And of course, we can also solve that for the n. N in that case is the logarithm of the y0 minus y0 star divided by y1 minus y0 star times 1 minus lambda. I have to check again. Plus lambda divided by the log of 1 over lambda. Now it's getting a little bit crowded down here, but that way we are able to plot or write everything on the same page. And of course, in the manuscript, you have all the nice equations that you can have a look at. So that is then, again, the second form of the Kremser equation also in this case. And now it depends, so to speak, what is specified. If it is the xn which is specified, or if it is actually the y1, and there we need to look again to realize what that actually means. So if the y1 is specified, that is the purity here. So the y1 is a purity on that side, the xn is a purity on that side. So if either of these purities is specified, you can choose the appropriate form of the Kremser equation and can solve that, so to speak. So if the y1 is specified, the y purity, you take this equation. If the xn is specified, you take this equation and solve it for your number of theoretical stages. And apparently that's a shortcut equation. Now, in order not to confuse things, but to give you some more options, there is also a set of additional equations that can be used, which are the so-called Tiller-Tour equations. And I don't, they are derived in the manuscript, so you can look up their derivation if you like. It's a little bit more, similarly tricky, but at the end, the things are getting a little bit more tricky in the end. And what we obtain there is finally y0 minus yn divided by the y1 minus y0 star equals 1 over lambda to the nth power. And of course, we can solve that for the n. So in that case, n equals the log of that ratio, so the y0 minus yn divided by y1 minus y0 star, and y0 star exactly being defined as above, divided by the log of the lambda, or the second option being, again, substituting the other way around, x0 minus x1 divided by xn minus x0 star equals lambda to the power of n. And also here we can evaluate the lambda, the log of x0 minus x1 divided by xn minus x0 star divided by log of lambda. And this, all these equations are the so-called Tiller-Tour equations, four equations. These are the Tiller-Tour equations. As I said, the Y0 star and the X0 star are defined as above, the lambda as well, and of course these equations are very well suited to solve the same problem. It depends now a little bit which way round you want to solve it, which variables are specified. Here you see, so to speak, that the both ends, so to speak, of X are specified in that that context. It depends, as I said, how you want to calculate those things. And of course, you realize that the X1 directly relates to the Y1, so you need to know the Y1 in this case as well. Here, it's the Yn, and that is, of course, related to the Xn, so those have to be known. And here you have to, so to speak, solve the balances first in order to get this other equation, whereas for the Kremser equation, you can avoid that, you just plug in what you have. Here you have to solve the balances, but on the other hand side, you realize these equations are much simpler than the Kremser equations. So for the Tiller 2 equations, the final results are a little bit simpler, but you have to evaluate the balances because you need to know the concentrations at both ends. Yeah, this being the equilibrium value to the Xn, which is a leaving theoretical stage, and so you have to solve that somehow. That somehow already contained, so to speak, implicitly in the Kremser equation. Well, now one can even do it in a simpler way, in a simpler fashion, because these are now equations that you need to calculate on your computer, on your calculator. So they are so simple that you indeed are able to solve it on the calculator or an Excel spreadsheet if you like. But one can go one step further, one can simplify it further, one can derive such a design diagram as it is shown here. I hope you can read it in this video. Anyway, it's plotted also in the manuscript, of course. Here we have exactly the ratios that we have found in the Kremser equation. So this is the y1 minus y0 divided y0 star divided by y0 minus y0 star. If the y1 is known, if the xn is known, xn minus x0 star divided by x0 over x0 star. This is the vertical axis. The horizontal axis is the number of theoretical stages, and then we have a variety of curves in between, and the numbers here indicate the lambda or the 1 over lambda, and which one is to be chosen. It depends on this axis, if this is the y ratio, if this is the x ratio. So if it's the y ratio, then this parameter here is the 1 over lambda. If we use the x ratio on this axis, then this these parameters are just the lambda. So if you, for example, choose the xn to be known, so this is the x ratio, then you choose a lambda. I don't know which is feasible to you. That depends on the flow rates. That depends on the equilibrium. Say it's 1.1, so we're on this curve here. And then we see that we need that we want to have this ratio, a depletion, so to speak, of down to 0.1. So we're on this 1.1 at the value of 1, and then we are actually here, so we can look it up, how many theoretical stages we need, and there we see that we need somewhere between 6 and 7, say 6.3 or so theoretical stages, and we can directly read that off that diagram. So very easy. So we can evaluate it this way directly in this graphical way, determine the number of theoretical stages, and that way are able then to design the process. Of course, one has to be cautious if one does that. There are many assumptions that are implied here, so it's always the equimolar counterflow or the carrier flow rates which are constant, equilibrium being a linear function, y as a function of x is being linear. That are of course certain assumptions that you always have to check if they really apply, and well, you can always evaluate that, but you have to be cautious if these assumptions are not really fulfilled in an appropriate way. Okay, so that's fine. So we know how to solve that, and we have seen thus that we can derive shortcut equations for all three different cases we regarded. And we realize that shortcut methods allow quick and easy calculation of the separation performance on a calculator or in an Excel spreadsheet, so directly straightforward. At the same time, they are based on severe assumptions, for example, on phase equilibrium. And these assumptions have to be checked individually for your specific case that you have. And finally, we should remind ourselves that the shortcut methods, because of these severe assumptions, can only give a very first approximation of the performance of the regarded process. But you get at least an idea. Does it make sense to think about extraction, or do you need 500 theoretical stages? Yeah, you can directly say that. Yeah, so one gets an idea if something works in principle or not. Of course, the final equipment design for that, you need to go into more detail, take into account all non-idealities, and then come up with the final design of the equipment. With that, I would like to say thank you for today, and I hope to see you again in the next video.